Hey everybody, welcome once again to The Nightstand, episode 6, y'all. You did it. Thanks for coming up here. You deserve it. You are awesome. Thank you. I'm Byron Anthos, your host.
This is part one of a two-part very special episode. I'm your co-host, Zelda.
And today we are talking about mental health because we figure there is no real big enough topic that keeps you up at night quite like your own mental health.
Yes, being alone with your thoughts right before you go to sleep.
Nobody needs that.
I don't want to relive something embarrassing from junior high in the last 5 minutes of consciousness.
I'm mad that you do that too. It means we spend too much time together.
Oh my gosh. Well, we're cracking up a little bit because we realized we recorded a great episode that didn't record.
We were kicking ass for like 10 minutes and realized we only recorded 4. But thank you guys for sticking with us.
Yeah, we'll loop it in.
That's why we're not doing this live.
It's been about 2 weeks since we've recorded and uploaded something. Lots of life has happened in between. So yes. Thank you for sticking with us because we are real people who have real jobs that aren't this.
Yeah.
At least not yet.
Well, that's her excuse. Mine is waiting on her ass. So in the past couple weeks, it's been my birthday.
Yay!
I think we mentioned in the loyalty episode that, you know, my grandfather was not doing well. He has passed away. He had a military funeral, which according to my grandmother, he would have hated. He said that he had bad experiences and didn't want any part of it. But funerals are for the living, not really for the dead. And we had a bit of a windfall, so we paid off some debt.
Woo!
Which, whoever says money can't fix all your problems, they can fix your problems when the problems are money.
It can't buy you love, but it can buy you a peace of mind.
But you know what my mom says? She says, like, more money doesn't fix money problems. Because usually the money problems will come from overspending or, you know, just not having the nest egg for when an emergency happens and things like that. And so actually just having it, if you're not applying it in the proper ways, it's not going to help the problem.
See, P. Diddy's Mo Money, Mo Problems. What was it, 97? I don't remember, but you all have the internet. You can look it up.
And I'm like Jay-Z, I got 100 problems now. By the way, take this with you. That's my favorite way to call somebody a bitch. You just look at them and be like, man, I got 100 problems now.
Just so nuanced.
It is. And the real ones know. But we are here talking about mental health, and so we want to know a little bit more about yours. So if you want to send us any information on your mental health strategies, some things you've overcome, some things that you do daily that just kind of help you get through the day, maybe you don't feel like you need to go through the day and you like to help others, tell us why. You can call or text us at 972-836-6275 or
email us at thenightstandpodcast@gmail.com.
Nobody has, so fuck y'all.
We're building an audience.
We really are. We need to talk to our new channel if we can swear.
You know, I'm trying to keep it.
I'm not. I'm not, because we're on YouTube until we're anywhere else.
Yes.
I will happily go back and edit all this if they need it. But, yeah. Which, by the way, announcement might be coming soon. We will do a little snippet for when things are a little more solid, but we are moving to another streaming service. We will let you guys know more as we know more. So, stay tuned for that.
Yes, so the emphasis on personal mental health, as brought about by the pandemic, COVID-19, a lot of people discovered we're doing a lot of stuff we don't really enjoy, and the whole world is stressed out, and then COVID made everyone just sit on their ass for a while. And I think that really brought to light some holes in the way that we live as a society. Everyone's stressed out all the time about something, whether it's paycheck to paycheck, your damn kids, you know, there's a lot of different stuff. Your spouse the divorce rate, I think, skyrocketed during COVID.
Because they actually saw each other for the first time in forever.
Yes, because I think people do a lot of things to put barriers in front of dealing with their own problems. And
drag me. Wow.
Not just you. There's other people that fall into
There's
category.
You as well.
Yeah. Oh.
There's you in this room, too. Yeah, Artie, what you going through? deadass. And I think that what was great about the situation that people were experiencing with that was that not only were they seeing that they weren't doing things that they were enjoying, but that they didn't have to in the way that they were.
Yes.
That was such a big one. And that's like that was a huge global shift, especially for a lot of companies, because you realize that everybody was like, beforehand, they'd be like, oh, it would be so great to work from home. Like, and then they're like, oh, I don't know if I could do that because I like the hustle and bustle. But then when they actually did it, you see more remote jobs now than ever.
Yes.
Because everyone realizes that, like, just being home itself is good for your mental health.
hell, I think even the effect on the housing market with all these people saying, oh, my job's fully remote. I don't have to live in this trash-ass city I don't want to live in anymore.
Hello.
I don't have to deal with the commute anymore. And I think...
And, like, administrative corporations really lost out because they would cut back so much cost.
Yeah. And when you have people who are neurodivergent or neurotypical, you need a different schedule that works for you that's not the 8-hour grind.
Yeah.
I can speak on that personally. I do have ADHD as diagnosed by a real medical professional.
Yeah, she needs a 12-hour grind.
And my brain just does not work in the same way of others. So I'm really glad that we're finally getting to a point at my employer where things are winding down. We're coming to the end of the semester. And some of the hustle and bustle and other people's emotions that I pick up on is going to really slow down. And I am looking so forward to that.
I mean, that's good. Like, I think it's harder on anything, any kind of profession that kind of latches onto, like, the school system. Because then you have, like, your waves of stress and your it's seasonal stress.
Yes.
You know when it's going to be the busiest. You know when you're going to have a break. You know when you're going to have a downfall. You know when you're going to have an uptick. Like, you know all of these things. And in a way, the preparation for it can kind of be good for your mental health. But still, just, like my mother was a teacher, and she's retired. And she was doing the same thing. She was like, I was overworked. Like, even during the summers. Teachers get such a bad rap.
No respect.
We love our teachers here.
Yes. Okay. Did you learn something? Thank a teacher.
Bruh, for real. You learn anything. If you can speak.
Thank a teacher.
Blue's Clues. No. Schoolhouse Rock. No, but, you know, knowing your triggers and, like, your moments of when you're going to be in a mood. Like, oh my God, remember, I did this earlier this year. Mm. It was, like, around January, and I knew things at work were going to be crazy.
Yes.
And so I, like, called you. I called a couple of other friends. I called my last co-host. And I was like, hey, just so you know, things are going to be crazy busy. I'm not in a bad place, but I'm going to be busy. I'm going to be home by 6, but I'm not going to have the mental capacity to, like, kind of deal with anything. So I love you. So unless it's, like, an actual emergency, you cannot do something. You are on fire and only my glorious piss can put it out. Like, unless it's anything like that, like, I have none of it for chit-chat.
No.
I just have nothing.
That's a great point for navigating your triggers. Instead of expecting the world to acquiesce to what you want, or even worse yet, which is unfortunately still very common, our society doesn't really treat you in a... I'll back that up. Not treat you. Teach you how to say, I can't be here for you right now. I'm going to have to be here for myself and have the ability to completely check out.
Boundaries.
It's like, we have said that, but oh, yeah, if you can come in on Saturday, that'd be great.
Yeah, because, like, you know, like, I think, you know, in the last 10 years, we have seen a surge of people actually prioritizing their mental health.
Yes.
Which is really, really good. And I think the pandemic did let people do that as well. Because let's face it, that was a globally... I'm not going to diminish or minimize anything that happened during the height of it, because we're still in it. Hi. But that it was the most unanimously stressful time of our life.
Ooh, yes.
There was a constant air that we were all... breathing.
Yes, hunty, we were all going through it.
We were. And so it was, you know, it was very carpe diem. It was, you know, change your job, do the things that are happy, see your family, divorce, whatever that you need to do to make you happy. Look, I'm all for a functional divorce. I really am. But we prioritize it now.
Yes.
And it's good to do that in an employment set, but I see a lot of people that are doing it personally as well.
Yeah, and I think it's made it more... less taboo and more okay to talk about, because one of the things about the pandemic I point out is all of the things that were uncomfortable and new experiences for much of the world were always someone's new normal. We used to work for a nonprofit, and that is a very stressful sector. It doesn't matter if you're teaching kids how to read or you're feeding people for a living. And our agency actually brought on a team of therapists and said, hey, if you all need someone to talk to, because we couldn't.
For y'all.
Yeah. Well, we couldn't not work. I worked in the house. I'm sorry, you were in the fields. But yeah, like, even that brought up a glaring difference in who can access mental health. How affordable is it for people? Because I think the ultimate thing that I see from people who are saying, oh, I love therapy. Oh, I'm so glad that you have the time and space and money to do that for yourself, It really should be something that is more affordable. I'm
more
not
accessible.
Saying accessible and affordable. Teladoc is great, but that requires that you have a steady internet connection or the ability to afford internet or somewhere where internet is. So
everything costs.
Our rural people out there. So I'm not saying don't go and seek help. I just think the process should be easier.
Yeah.
But your mental health is ultimately your responsibility. Just like you know your triggers, I don't think it's anyone else's responsibility to create a padded room for you to live in, always waiting for the other shoe to drop or walking on eggshells because they don't know when you're going to go off again.
No, deadass. And, like, it's...
Or go out.
Yeah, because, like, it's kind of weird to talk about accountability with mental health because you don't want to seem like you're, like, attacking people with any disabilities or anything like that.
Absolutely not.
But the hard truth of it is that the world does not know your life. It does not know your specific way of life. And they're not going to know it with a handshake. This is why, like, whenever we talk about relationships and everything, you hear somebody say, like, oh, well, I was really triggered, and then this happened and everything, and then I dumped his ass. I'm like, well, was this a conversation you had before?
Yeah.
They're like, no, but you don't understand. He was supposed to know this. I'm like, no, because one thing, I will fly this banner until the day I die. Implicit boundaries and implicit expectations are the first to be crossed and not achieved.
Yeah, even if you're assaulting someone, like verbal assaults, you have to tell someone that that is not something that you enjoy, or that you have to tell them directly that's not something you want them to do again. You know, outside of, you know, hauling off and calling someone completely out of their name in Walmart. But there are other, it's just a thing. You have to let people know what does and does not work for you, and it's uncomfortable.
And kind of like navigating your triggers in the moment.
Yes.
Because you kind of owe that to yourself to preserve a relationship with somebody. I always do this kind of three-strike rule, where it's like the first time you're triggered, let them know because it was a mistake and they didn't know.
Street.
There was straight ignorance there. They had no idea what they were doing.
Textbook.
Yes, exactly. Strike two, because they're now you're having them break a conditioning. If they're used to behaving in a certain way, now they have to change this behavior in a certain situation because of your feelings. Allow them that little bit of time. Third time, might feel a little deliberate. Now we kind of have a problem. We need to have a serious talk.
Yes. And an example of two would be people who don't shake hands, but like, I'm a hugger. Okay, I'm not a hugger. Like, if I don't know you like that, I'm not just going to come up and hug you.
Yeah.
And so for people to say, I'm a hugger, but not respect people's boundaries of, I'm not a hugger. Let me get to know you a little bit more before there's physical interaction. And then on time three, they just come up and hug you behind, like the scene from Ghost.
I kind of want people to... Okay, here's a specific text message that I actually want to get from people. Why are you a hugger?
Yeah,
I want to know. Like, is it a more of a willingness to show, like, you are friendly? Or is it something that you specifically need from other people?
Oh, yeah.
I want to know that.
I've never explored that. But yes, call or text us with your answers at 972-836-6275.
Bumper. Or email us at thenightstandpodcast@gmail.com.
Good, what to do. But yes, so it is an uncomfortable conversation to have, and I don't think you should call someone out on it. I'll back that up again. I'm going to do a lot of backing
There's
up.
There's ways you can do it. Yeah, you suck at this.
no, I think letting someone know in the moment... And if you can't do it in the moment, then give them time or offer to arrange a meeting to let someone know how you feel. I don't like when people act on their emotions instead of telling you why you're upset.
Oh, fuck that.
Like, just, you know, I'm not going to know. Even if I've known you for years, there are still, I mean, even with us, there's boundaries we've crossed with each other that we didn't know were boundaries until we had to address them.
It's okay. I forgive you.
Okay. I believe you. Yeah, so setting those boundaries in the form of, and we've talked about this on other episodes, just letting people know. You don't have to haul out and cuss someone out. Just say, hey, this doesn't work for me, and here's why.
It really does help to kind of be descriptive, and I think that's one of the things that you could benefit from in therapy, because therapy isn't a fix-all for everything, but it can also be tailored for what you're looking for. So you can actually say, I really want to work on navigating my emotions in the moment and developing some communication skills. That would be completely helpful to help you have a... It might feel like you're doing it for everybody else, but you're actually doing it for you.
Yeah.
You are letting people know, this is what I need.
It's a mental health wheel of fortune. We're giving you RSTLNE, and we need you to fill in the rest. Please continue to spin the wheel.
Is that how R.L. Stein got his name?
I do not know, but I know those are the words that... The letters that start the most words in the English language.
RSTLNE. Like, yeah, all he did was add an I. I'm pretty sure it's how R.L. Stein got his pen name.
Someone look that up and let us know.
He's not going to admit it. But yeah, boundaries are great for your mental health. And, you know, just being able to navigate, like, it's so good to be able to navigate your own emotions because you find out so much about yourself.
Yes. I was going to add that sometimes I know how something makes me feel, but I don't always recognize that as a boundary being crossed.
You also don't know why sometimes.
Yeah. Sometimes you have to sit with that feeling and ask yourself, this is something that I do when I'm really, like, upset or I'm feeling emotionally flooded, which is when you just can't even, there's too many options on what to do or not enough options.
That's why I haven't called you for a week.
Or just too much stuff going on, and I think, all right, why am I feeling this way? And if I can't identify the feeling, what was the situation that led to the feeling that I don't have a name for? And was someone else involved in that? Or was it something that I interpreted and didn't tell the other person? Because sometimes I think boundaries that get people from 0 to 912 are things that they know bother them, but they've never bothered to quantify to themselves.
I mean, it really just, I'm going to repeat myself. It just helps. Like, it helps you know yourself. And it just helps you navigate the world so much better. And it helps the world kind of navigate you.
And even though we're the best of best friends, soulmates, etc., we are not each other's therapists. We can talk to each other and like, hey, I need to work through this. Are you willing to workshop this with me? But neither one of us are degreed professionals.
No, there's specific times when I like, and that's something that I think was kind of like the cornerstone of therapy for the most part, is the more you talk about things and talk about yourself, there's a reason why a lot of the basic trope for therapy and TV and movies and everything is like, how does that make you feel? It's because really they're kind of nudging you to the answer you already have.
Yes. Just someone being a reflective surface for you.
A soundboard. Kind of like what we want to be. That's what we want to be. You know, we're not, like, there are times when I've talked to you about, like, relationship issues or something like that, and then, like, by the end of just venting to you, I'm like, I know what makes sense.
Yeah.
I just had to hear it again.
Or I just had to say it out loud for the first time.
Yes.
Like, we've both watched the entirety of Frasier, but
hell yeah,
not psychologists.
I went to a bat mitzvah once. It doesn't make me Jewish.
So, on to boundary setting. One boundary for me is people diagnosing other people.
Oh, God, I hate this.
I think sometimes people go at it with the best of intentions. There was this thing we saw online where people were breaking up with each other.
Oh, yeah, this is your thing. Yeah, talk to me about this.
So, people were breaking up with friends saying, oh, well, I like your example earlier. I realize that you're exhibiting some narcissistic tendencies, and that's triggering for me, and this is no longer a healthy environment, and therefore I advocate that we
shake
no longer
be friends.
Shake your PhD down. Yeah, I think a therapist is someone who has been trained to recognize certain signs. Also, never forget that your therapist is working with you and not the rest of the world simultaneously. I don't know who has that much money to do that.
Fair.
But you, I just don't advocate for diagnosing other people. I even take up qualms with people who say, oh, that's crazy.
Were you going to say Umbridge?
Crazy. I was thinking
I
of
feel
it.
Like, oh, you should have leaned into Umbridge.
I will not.
I even take Umbridge. With,
yes,
much
Umbridge.
No, like, completely. I have known many people that just diagnose people left and right, and it's because the people that I find the most guilty about this are people that are in therapy.
Yes.
And I think this is kind of a checkpoint for anybody who is in the mental health profession. I would love to know your opinion on this, because to me, I see that unless it is specifically related to the patient themselves, I think that any use of psychological terminology and jargon can kind of like sway the way they view the world. And the problem with that is they're not professionals.
Yes.
And there's no reason for them to be. And I actually got pushback on this because I did talk to another friend about this, and she said, well, I know enough about narcissistic tendencies to recognize them in other people. And it's like, yes, you can recognize the tendency. What you don't know is the motive behind it, the history of the person, the lifestyle that they lead have, any of the other factors that a medical professional is going to take into consideration in the hours that they spend talking to you to come up with that diagnosis. You're just giving them with a handshake.
And plus, the whole thing about a narcissist is their inability to care and
narcissists are just easy
people.
To talk about, by the way. They probably think this podcast is about them.
Don't you?
But I have been around these people, and you know, there's people that are like, you know, diagnosing me when I made it very clear that they don't know me because they don't talk about me. They never tried to get to know me, but they seem to just take my actions to mean something that are not what they are. I've been called, you know, money grubbing, which where where, you know, been called manipulative, which, fair. But I can't. I know how to understand. I understand people, and that may come off as manipulative because I know how to calm people. I know how to excite them. I know how to do all these things. But they do it from a place that, one, they're emotional. They're going through a hard time.
Sometimes malicious.
Sometimes malicious. And it's not coming from a place like that. When one thing that we all need to really understand is that everybody's dealing with something. I think everybody can benefit from therapy.
Yes.
But the one thing is that, damn it, I had it and it was going to be really good.
Sharpen your tools.
No, it wasn't that. It wasn't that kitten poster. Oh, God, I was on a roll.
Oh, this happens sometimes.
It does happen. I'll come back to it at some point.
Yes, but I think, you know, again, back to the everyone should try therapy at least once. But if you can't, I mean, there's other alternatives like journaling, talking to a friend.
Self-exploration.
Self-exploration. I think that one is a big one.
Which is different than self-care.
Yes.
Self-care is kind of, I view self-care as like kind of a pampering, I view self-care as more physical.
I view it as a planned and physical intentional distraction.
I'd say view it as a physical application. So things like, you know, a pedicure, manicure, facial, hair, massage, like self-care, taking care of your body.
Oh, okay.
And then
I see.
Kind of getting that. That's how I attribute self-care, which I believe would be different than like self-reflection and things like that.
Yes.
Get into your yoga.
Yes. So there's yoga, there's coloring books, there's puzzles, there's a lot of different things. Some people like to do handicrafts. Yes. He's pointing to a table.
I collect 20 years worth of action figures.
You know, if it gets you somewhere,
but I realized why I did it actually, is because, when I was working so much and stressing out and freaking out and everything, that would be like a treat to myself.
Oh, like a little dopamine hit.
Yes. It's basically that. Like I have some that I haven't even opened primarily because I need a bigger case. Shut up. I know I have a problem, but like, it is true. Like they would be impulse buys because I needed something to make me feel good in that moment.
Yes. And that's. I'm glad that you said that because it's not a substitute for actually dealing with the problem.
No.
It is a very pretty Band-Aid, sometimes an expensive Band-Aid, depending on what you're into. But just, you know, having the tools from someone outside of your life, because I don't even like when people try to diagnose themselves. Like, did you get your MD on Google? Because they're not a real university. And knowing yourself, like, physician, know thyself. Knowing yourself can be a good start. I am one of those people that I know exactly what my problems are most of the time. I don't often have the solution on how to work through those. And so that's where having someone who has an objective point of view and training is able to help me bridge those two things together and continue to move forward. And it's not like a one and done. That's another thing that I see from people. Mental health is a lifetime journey. In fact, I like to say mental homeostasis.
Hello.
Because you can get out of balance and bring yourself back into balance. Just like your health can be declining and you can bring it back, but it's a constant, it's going to change and move with you depending on where you are in your life and where you are mentally.
For those of you that don't know, and the only reason why I'm going to touch on this is because I took an anatomy class and we did cover homeostasis. Homeostasis is actually, like she says, it's kind of a balancing act that your body does on itself. It's like when you're hot and you sweat, it's to balance out your temperature. Things like that are like, it's like a biological hardwiring to help keep the body in balance. So for those of you that don't know what homeostasis is, there you go.
Yeah. And
Public Schoolhouse Rock.
And the balance is a balancing act.
Homeschool House Rock.
Oh my God.
Oh my God. Homeschool House Rock. Oh my God. We need to make this happen.
Trademark it. That'll be our next podcast. I don't know what we're talking about.
We're just going to make animated videos. There's going to be things like 2,000 years ago when the Earth was born.
Gosh. Catch me in the firmament. So not diagnosing the world or other people.
It's not your responsibility, and frankly, it's not your place.
Yes. No matter how much of a place of love you think that you're coming from, I think diagnosing other people and letting someone know that you care enough about them that you're advocating that they seek help are two different things.
Completely.
Also.
Completely. You know, because it's one thing to tell somebody, is like,
bitch, you need therapy.
I would actually take that as opposed to saying, you have narcissistic tendencies, and I'm going to need... Sorry, guys. Once again, narcissistic, it's just an easy go-to to talk about because it's been such a buzzword for the last couple years that's why we're doing it. We have no issue with any narcissists in our family. I certainly don't, but...
I don't know if I know any.
We, you must be it then.
Narcissist in the
Look
night.
Around the room. If you don't see one, you are one.
I forgot what movie it was that said, you know, when a narcissist dies, the universe ends.
For them.
Yes, exactly. So it's one of those. But
you know, it's not your place to do it, but it's one thing to say, like, hey, I've recognized these really, you know, toxic behavior that you're exhibiting that's inhibiting your ability to, you know, maintain healthy relationships with you, versus like, hey, you know, you seem to be kind of in a funk and everything. I kind of went through something similar. You know, I talked to a therapist and I got a lot of really good things out of it. Maybe it might help you as well.
Yes, I like the insertion of the word maybe, because you don't know all that is going on with that person.
No.
And you don't want to presume. I think a really interesting real life case in point is, unfortunately, a man who was suffering from mental illness was choked to death on a New York subway.
Yeah.
And I think that really just called in how people with mental illness are treated.
We talked about this week. I completely forgot about this, and I'm glad that we're talking about mental health. We were talking about this exact situation, and everybody had said that, you know, that it's common in New York, and it's common in a lot of metropolitan public spaces where you see people publicly displaying signs of mental illness. Which, first of all, you don't know that.
Yeah.
You don't know that. However fair it may be to assume that and everything, you don't know what you are seeing. The problem that I have attributed this to is that we, as a society, have not agreed to how we treat mental illness in public.
Or care for the people in the same level.
Exactly. Because I had heard somebody talk about, they went to New York, they were on a subway, they saw this guy, and he was like, you know, being a little weird and everything, and they just put their head down and ignored it. That's what we've been taught to do.
Yeah.
Oh, don't look at him. You know, like, even when you were a kid and your parents were like, don't look at them, don't make eye contact with them, they're acting strangely, you don't want to be around that and everything. It puts a stigma to it, as opposed to having a systematic way for people to get the help they need so that they don't go too far.
And I think that just shows a real breakdown in society that I will link back to the pandemic. When everybody was going through it, it was okay. But I feel like we've gotten out of the quarantine phase, at least for now. I don't know what the future holds. Not wishing that on any of us, knocking on wood. I think...
Particle, but yeah.
There's a certain level of acceptable mental illness. When a celebrity has a breakdown and says, hey, I'm going to log off of social media for a while because it's beginning to affect me, everyone's like, oh, yes, work, get it, do what you got to do, get that work. But then when you
advocacy,
see someone...
we need to talk about mental health more often.
And then when you see someone who is on the street who appears to be having some sort of mental episode, or in the cases of violent mental episodes, it's different. All like of a sudden, it's us versus them.
And like I said, there hasn't been a societal agreement on how to handle this. And that's why, first of all, I have issues with the incident that happened anyway.
Yes.
Because apparently they're like, oh, well, he was a Marine and he knew what to do. If he was a Marine, he knew how not to kill him.
That's true. And I think that's, you've had...
And I'm going to say that, and I'm not going to say this on behalf of Marines. I'm going to say this about anybody that has had any combat training, not just military. People that are in martial arts, people that that exercise handguns and usage or anything like that. You know how not to kill somebody.
Yes.
When you are given the skills to do it, you know not to. 5-minute chokehold, you knew what you were doing.
And to feel like it was the thing that hurts my heart the most about it is there was a train car full of people that simply watched this happen, and because this person was believed to be mentally ill, that they were in some way deserving of that and not deserving of someone to be an upstander and advocate that this should not be going on. I think there's a lot of confusion. This is where I'm going to bring the police in. We don't need to call the police always. There are definitely some situations for a mental health episode. It's part of the problem statistically for people who are on the street suffering from, you know, who are unhoused, a euphemism I prefer to use for homeless, because there are people that prefer to live that way. But for the people that don't, all right, you get them off the street, you put them in jail for a little bit, you force them to go to some federal incarceration or state place of incarceration where they are then forced to take medication, and then when their sentence is done, you let them out. What happens when they no longer have access to the therapist that they were seeing or the medication that they were taking, or they've gotten better with the medication and still believe, oh, well, because I'm on these pills, it's not doing anything, I'm just going to get off of them.
And see, that's the problem, is that the one thing that we kind of have agreed to as a society is that mental health is something to fix. And the problem with that is that that implies that there is a standard of behavior, which there are some in some cases. There are some societal norms. There are some acts of courtesy, human decency, that, yes, we can all agree to. But as far as certain behaviors, it's like if there's any exhibition of anything being slightly off the norm, then it has to be fixed. It has to be calmed. It has to be quiet. You see this with kids.
Yes.
Whenever they act out, they're trying to understand their emotions, you tell them to stop, you tell them to shut up, you tell them to go to your room, you tell them to go do something else rather than actually sit there and talk about what they're feeling.
And then they grow up to be adults who don't know how to deal with their emotions.
Who are banning books.
And they're having to navigate the rest of the world of people who also don't know how to do that.
And that's why a lot of, you'll see a lot of political swayings go from when you're, if you were raised from age 1 to 18, heavy conservative, you'll go to college and become heavily liberal. Not for any kind of political leaning, but that you just see that there is more diversity in the world.
The pendulum swings.
Yes, and that people deal with things in different ways rather than the one that you just had.
And there's not, I like that point, because there's not a one size fits all. That's why I like to use the word mental homeostasis instead of mental health, because it can change. You can go to therapy that one time and have worked out through years of issues, but eventually your tools will grow dull, or you will encounter a situation that tool does not work for. Not every situation is a hammer, and not every solution is a nail, but you have to be able to know when to
strike
navigate
that, reverse
those.
It.
Yeah, one of those. You know what I was trying
you
to
do. You were right, but you were the reversed. Like the solution is the nail. Okay,
yeah, no.
All right, yeah, sure.
But just, there's not a one-size-fits-all, and once you're, you know, you've gone to therapy for a few months or years, and you feel like I'm in a position where I can utilize these tools and see how far that gets me, I don't think that means you are, quote, done.
And that's the thing. One of the people we were talking to about this thing, she even said, like, could nobody have shown any kind of compassion before this thing escalated? He was asking for food, you know, doing whatever, and you see this a lot. In the unhoused community, that they do ask for, you know, a little bit of help, a little bit of assistance, anything like that. And it costs nothing to do it morally. It's actually a benefit. And it's like I said, you know, we've kind of agreed to a standard of behavior that's really kind of non-specified.
Yeah.
It's a non-specified standard. And then when we see somebody deviate from it, we're just like, oh, they deserve to... It's like, oh, God, what was it? It was like some show where somebody was like homeless and they're like, it's because they did something bad.
Yeah.
It's like like you said, they do feel like there's a deserving factor for people's misfortunes. And frankly, I blame American capitalism for that one.
I blame capitalism, period, the end.
Fuck capitalism!
But to say, oh, well, because the other thing that implies to me is that it's okay to suffer in silence as long as you're not having outbursts that affect how other people have to go about their day. Struggle through it.
Yeah, I'm gay. This might seem like a new thing for some of y'all, but I'm gay. And let me tell you a little bit something about how the gay community was taught to be for a long time.
Or not be in public.
Yes. And that's what's kind of sickening. I actually did have, I made a post the other day about transphobia.
Mm.
And let me get my direct quote. I'm going to not misquote myself here for a second.
It's the least you can do.
It's the least I can do for myself.
Is it a hammer or a nail?
it's such a hammer. I said, okay, so hot take. So here in Texas, there was a legislation that banned gender-affirming care in schools.
Boo.
You sent me the link. I'm going to be honest, I didn't read it, but I have kind of followed it for the most part. No, I followed the legislation.
Yeah, no,
but I didn't read what
you
sent. But I said hot take, because I believe this in general. Regardless of what's happening where, when the buzzword of... Yeah, the heteronormative conservative side right now is, you know, gender affirming care. And I said, okay, hot take. Gender affirming care affects cisgendered kids and teens as well.
Yep.
But you didn't think about that, did you? Because if you did, and then you'd have to change the language, and then you would have to just admit that you're transphobic. And yes, transphobic is the proper term because you are afraid. You are afraid that by accepting someone's right to exist differently than you are, that it somehow means that your way of life is incorrect. This is a wrong way of thinking. Do you, let other people do them, stay in your lane, kindness is free. This is exactly what we talk about when we say homophobic and transphobic behavior, because then they'll be like, I'm not afraid of gay people. I'm like, yes, you are. You're afraid that if it's okay, it means you're not.
Yeah, or that your lifestyle is some way being infringed, and I'm not trying to equate being gay or being a trans person with being mentally ill. I think that's furthest from the truth. But
like, I see this all the time where we were taught to, yeah, be gay in silence.
Just like,
right fucking now with Target.
Yeah, what is up with that? I think that's, I mean, the acquiescence and how far these things are willing to go, I think it just puts people into a cage and it feels like the cage is getting smaller.
Yeah, Target's barely has customers anyway. Every time I go, there's like 12 people and 6 of them work there.
I mean, I still like Target, but, you know, I'm choosy about where I spend my money. I will boycott because money is power. But yes, like it feels like the cage is getting smaller and the paradigm of what is quote okay and quote normal is getting smaller, and it's getting smaller in a way that I don't think we've seen in our lifetime. And to just bring it back to the mental health thing, I think...
You mean the actual topic of the show?
I mean, there's lots of tangents. We are tangential people. But to say, oh, well, there's only one way to be normal. And the moment you cease behaving in that way, you are no longer of value to anyone, and why should we care about you? So, like, the kindness thing. I'm not saying that you have to go up to a person who seems to be having a mental health episode. It's scary. I've witnessed it
before. We're talking to you, huggers.
Go hug everybody. So there are situations in which you do have to be careful, and there could be a threat to that person's health. I mean, that person being a threat to themselves or being a threat eventually to other people. But just the dead-on bullseye, there's something wrong with you. I'm crossing the street. You don't deserve to be treated like a human. I don't even have to look at you. It's just sad. It's just sad and pathetic in a way that I don't think the richest or, you know, quote, greatest country in the world should be treating its citizens.
I mean, the biggest takeaway that I'm having right now, because, you know, as a gay man in the state of Texas, you know, my time here is numbered. I look at what's happening in, like, school boards and everything like that. When they're talking about banning certain books, they're talking about, you know, banning certain language. They're talking about, you know, certain topics. They just don't want to do this and everything. And I get it that it comes from a place of wanting to protect children from certain things. But the problem is that those certain things are just an inherent part of life. And you're teaching them how to, you know, just kind of be segregated from it, that it's wrong, that the rest of the world is wrong except for your tiny-ass little zip code, and that it doesn't help them. You're actually stunting their mental health because they can't see the world for, you know, the diversity that it is, because it has to fit in what these two people from the generation before thought the world is supposed to be.
Yeah, and it creates...
The world's bigger than your zip code.
I can say for myself, it creates a schism where... You can, because I went through this, you can recognize, oh, I'm bi. But what does that mean? And where does that language come from? And how do you find, it's, when you learn something new about yourself that in this situation feels like you weren't supposed to learn because you weren't exposed to it.
You ever feel like you're only going with girls just because you're supposed to?
It's alienating. So for people that want to build community by making people the same or ensuring that there is a similar experience across different lines.
Echo chamber.
Exactly. So we're not thinking about the mental health harm that we're doing to people who are now being told that the way that they are is illegal or a sin or an abomination. You can pick up on those things without those words being said. And when you start to internalize that language, it's really hard to love yourself. And it's really hard to know to seek help because you feel like you can't trust people or you will be outed.
I will say that it's probably why I'm so cynical, because I know that if I really believed any of what anybody told me about the existence of the world, I probably would have killed myself a long time ago because I was told that I should. 'Cause there are people on opposite end of the country, opposite end of the world, hell, maybe even one of my neighbors, who hates me for what I am and thinks that I should die and has not even met me.
And that applies to people.
Try living with that.
Yeah.
And then talk to me about mental health.
Yeah, and I'm really scared that the suicide rate is already exponentially and disproportionately high in the LGBTQIA+ community. All of this stuff going on now is just going to make that worse, and I can't help but think that that's an intended side effect from
it's more prevalent in the youth as well. That's the problem. You may think that you're protecting kids, you're killing them.
I mean, we have 9-year-old kids who are bullied that are, sorry, trigger warning here, we'll put it on the episode, that are killing themselves. Like, what? How do you even know to do that at 9 years old? But the fact that you feel so badly about who you are as a person that you no longer want to be here, I can't imagine. I've had some pretty tough shit happen to me in my life, but I can honestly say I've never gotten to that point. Because one, I think there's always someone that has it worse than me and they're living through their day or don't have a choice. But to just not see that as a consequence of an action, just like those people on the subway didn't think that that person was going to get murdered or manslaughtered during that situation, it's like you can't fully see the ripple effect of what you're doing if you're only thinking about yourself and keeping yourself and people who think like you comfortable. So I think you can apply that to mental health. There are some cultures that, you know, black and brown people out there, we don't talk about shit outside the house. We don't even talk about shit with people in our immediate family. So that acculturation also has to change. It is okay to get help.
I think it's a generational thing too.
It is.
Because you'll see how you can watch a lot of congressional hearings. You can see a lot of city council meetings where everyone's like, well, you know, 15, 20 years ago, we didn't have any of this. Yes, you did. You had all of these things. They just weren't labeled properly. They weren't identified. And people were told to just keep it to themselves.
As long as there have been people, there have been people with mental health issues. Yes.
As long as there's been mental, there's been health.
Yes. As long as someone has had an independent thought, they may have had a thought or two that went wrong.
You just thought about The Simpsons again, didn't you?
No.
The button.
Oh, I didn't think about the button.
I thought about the button.
Silent alarm activated.
Independent thought alarm.
Yes. So I just think you...
I said alarm.
Alarm.
I have been mixing my words today. Alert and alarm. 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 Alarm.
Alarm.
Independent thought alarm.
I'm glad we can laugh at this. It was getting pretty heavy for a while.
I have been watching that clock, making sure we've been recording this whole fucking time.
Yes. I mean, it's hard, and do what you need to do for yourself. I think when you are advocating for yourself and your mental health, if you are encountering people who are asking you to do otherwise, that may be a person that no longer needs to be in your situation. If you are bettering yourself through therapy or discovering that some people in your family or in your orbit are toxic and you want to set boundaries, which means, unfortunately, you're not going to come home for insert holiday here dinner or, you know, talk to people more than what you can mentally
drag me
sustain. No, I mean, I think it's totally true. If someone is not enhancing your life experience and are instead draining you or advocating for you to do something that you know is not in your best interest, then that's, you know, that's a baby step for mental health.
Yeah. And truth positive, like, unless you are interested in preserving the relationships with family, friends, significant other, etc., you don't really you're not required to give too much explanation.
No.
You really don't have to. You can I think that might have been the biggest issue I had when you were talking about how people were like breaking up with their friends and everything. I'll just stop talking to you. I'll just stop talking. They'd be like, "Hey, I feel like we're drifting." I'd be like, "Yeah, I've just been really busy." And then, you know, I did an episode somewhere else about ghosting. Like,
yeah.
But I mean, there are ways to do that. That I feel like the breaking up,
it's hard to do.
Shut up. it's also because. Why do you feel the need to explain? That's a good question to ask. I'm not saying that you don't have to explain. I'm just saying you need to ask yourself, why do I feel the need to explain? With a relationship, I kind of get it. If you live together, you kind of need to know where things went wrong so that you can have, like, the divvying of a property and everything like that.
Yeah.
Like, that makes sense. You have built a life together. You need to know where things weren't going wrong. However, that usually comes at the tail end of actually trying to fix these issues. Don't just break up out of nowhere after a certain amount of time. I think it's silly.
Yeah.
Like, face the issues.
Juvenile.
Yeah. Unless it's, like, abuse.
Yeah.
Fuck
off. Leave.
Fuck off. They can leave. They can leave. You can leave. Everybody can leave on that one. But, you know, like, for the most part, you don't really require much, especially when you find that you've kind of been repeating yourself to somebody. Like, you can just say, hey, look, I just really don't feel like we should associate anymore for whatever reason. Like, you know, a lot of the people that I am friends with, I've had some professional association with as well, you know, because a lot of my past endeavors have been very, you know, entertainment, very interpersonal, everything like that. So everybody that is pretty much my friend, I've worked with. So there are times when I've had to tell them, hey, I don't think we can work together. But I think there's been very few where it's like, I don't think we can work together and I don't think we should be friends anymore.
Yeah.
But it's happened. And I've had to tell them, oh, I remember the thing I was going to say. It was, wow, just because you understand somebody's emotions and their attitude, their thinking, does not mean you have to agree with or accept the behavior.
Ooh.
That is a very, very hard one for people that are facing that to understand, because they feel like they're not being heard, that they're not being validated. And you're like, no, I understand your emotions. I understand why you reacted the way you did. I don't agree with what you did.
Yeah. Girls hitch hallelujah.
Yes.
And that's true, because my spouse.
So glad I remember before we ended this episode.
My spouse and I have had that conversation as well, because one of the things I will say sometimes is, you aren't listening. And I've stopped saying that because their response was, no, I hear you.
I just don't agree.
And I'm like, oh, well, sit my ass down.
That's a big one, because I've seen a lot of people, I've seen debates on YouTube and everything like that, where people are like, well, you're not validating my feelings. You're not understanding. It's like, no, what you're saying is, you're not agreeing with me.
Yes.
You're not on my side.
And there's a difference.
There is a difference. I understand that somebody pissed you off and you behaved this way, but then you doubled down and you kept going, and then you just made things bigger than it needed to be. I don't agree with the rest of that behavior.
Yeah. So acting in a way that is mentally healthy for yourself. Sometimes, and I did this when I was going through counseling, I kind of didn't take on any new friends or projects. I knew that I had to.
We're full.
Yes, there's no vacancy in my life right now.
Nerve in the end, Mary.
And I needed to, because going through that and unraveling and unpacking whatever uns you want to put in there requires that you dedicate yourself to that. Yes, that is one thing to, you know, do your 1 or 2 hours of therapy with your therapist a week. But you have to do your homework.
Hell yeah.
And doing your homework sometimes means recognizing, I am not in a place to bring on new people or new passions in my life. And this is time for me.
It's me. Hi. I'm the problem. It's me.
So also give yourself time to do that. So if you have to take a sabbatical or check out of overscheduling yourself to be a better self for you, or sort out what you're doing for yourself versus what you're doing to get by and perform for other people, then do that.
What is Byron's number one rule?
Your relationship with yourself is longer than your relationship with someone else.
Anybody else. Anybody else. You owe it to yourself to do the work. I said this to somebody who was dealing with, you know, I've been dabbling into the polyamory community.
Yes.
Dealing with communication situations and things like that. I did my workshop a couple of months ago. And this one said that he left his polycule because he felt like there was a boundary of, you know, not having some privacy. He, any issues that he was having or that his partner was having with him, he would tell to another metamore, and he just felt like there was a violation of privacy there. And I asked him, was this an implicit boundary? Because if it wasn't, you kind of owed it to yourself to set it and explain it and say, hey, I'm not comfortable with this, and preserve your own relationship. It's not about them. It's about you.
Yeah.
Because otherwise everyone's going to disappoint you and you're going to leave everybody.
Yeah. It's
not good for you.
No, it's not. And I think, maybe controversial here, in a situation like that, I don't think it's immediately the other person's fault.
Get out!
If they didn't know that they were violating a boundary of yours and you didn't say, hey, this is a conversation between us and the four walls.
Strike one. You don't know.
You don't know. Strike two. Assuming that that person was going to know based on an emotional outburst. You can blow up at the person and say, I can't believe you did this. I can't believe you did that. But did you tell them not to? And
right?
It sounds silly. It really does.
It's not.
But if you didn't tell them, this bothers me and here's why.
Yes.
You have to give them the ability to course correct the behavior before you shut them down and lock them out.
And I have seen this. I was watching a YouTube stream where somebody is actually going through this, and he goes through an arc of what he calls bridge burning, where somebody does something that pisses him off, and he just kind of burns the bridge entirely. And he says, like, I feel like it's obvious that people should know that this is just going to piss somebody off. And I'm like, yes, but you present yourself in a way that you would not be upset by it. Yeah. So people don't know that you're upset by it.
But Shaka, you're not every woman.
You're not.
It's not all in you.
Okay, we need to stop.
Some people are just not going to understand that. And so, you know.
Different background, different history. You don't get to diagnose them.
No. And you have to tell them. Anytime you are in a new relationship with someone, you don't have to give them your resume of likes and dislikes. Although it would make the world a hell of a lot easier. But you can't swipe left or right in a real life conversation. You have to tell people, hey, this is uncomfortable, or this is hard for me, or I don't know how to say this. However you want to preface it. But then let them know. What you did or said or whatever, you know, it was not okay with me, and here's why. You are still ultimately responsible for your feelings. No one makes you feel feelings, but people may trigger feelings in you with their actions.
I think it would definitely benefit you that if you are somebody that doesn't know, that you know you were triggered by things, like you didn't, like you said, you don't have to go and give them the full-blown checklist on a first date, but it would benefit you to go see a professional to help navigate for when those triggers occur. And yes, to be able to say, like, in the moment that you are triggered, to be like, okay, I need you to stop, and I need you to know that this isn't about you. Yes. You did do something, but you don't know you're doing it. Let me deal with my emotions real quick, and then I'll explain. We're still good.
Yeah. And if someone doesn't come back from that, or you don't get a second date, or no one wants to meet up with you again.
Oh my God, those of you that say, like, oh, I don't want anybody with any emotional baggage, fuck off.
I mean,
fuck off. You are not picture perfect.
No one comes.
That's emotional baggage right there.
Yeah, no one. This is double negative.
Do it.
No one doesn't have emotional baggage. It's just,
nobody doesn't like Sara Lee.
That's where I was thinking. I wish there was another way that I could rephrase that, but pound cake sounds awful good right now. But yeah, I think, you know, if you have an instance or a thing that works for you to let people know when your boundaries are being violated, or if you'd like to share a situation where you would like some help or crowdsourcing with how to deal with someone who is violating your boundaries or tickling your mental health in a way that's not your fancy, call or text us at 972-836-6275.
You can also email us at thenightstandpodcast@gmail.com. And also, guys, we are on Discord. There is going to be a link that's going to be in the description. So you can go ahead and click that. Sometimes I'm in it. Sometimes I'm not. But let's build a community. Let's actually start talking to each other. I will moderate it. No bullying, no name calling, because frankly, it's just immature, and I'll ban you.
You'll get booted so quick.
Yeah. But thank you guys so much for joining us. And sorry it's been a couple weeks. It will be a little bit longer before we get back on season 2. I know there's only 6 episodes, but there's a reason. And we will have a little short that's going to come up that will tell you why once we know a little bit more.
Jinx. Let us know what you would like to see in the next season. We're kind of doing things that mean a lot to us, or things that we have experience with that we can navigate through.
We're going to do a little bit more visual stuff next time.
Ooh.
I'm going to make like a backdrop.
This is for the voyeur in you.
Ha! So, thank you guys once again. I am, of course, your host, Byron Anthos.
I'm Zelda.
And we will see you guys next time. Till then, don't stay up too late.